While the local training of Gambian doctors is still in its infancy, the training of nursing staff has been a long-standing activity of the Department of State for Health and Social Welfare. The Community Health Nurses School at Mansakonko, headquarters of the Gambia's Lower River Division, has been turning out trained staff for the country's health services for more than 20 years now.
We are trained here. From here, we'll go to the field at the grassroots level to work with the community concerning about our health preparing things.
You are at what stage of the course now?
We are the second year.
This means the first. You are nearing the end of your course.
Exactly, yes.
So, are there any exams after the course?
Yes, after the 2 years program, there is final exams, which you will sit on it. When you pass, you will be absorbed by the State Department of Health, and after you will be posted in the various PSC villages or in the health centers.
Why have you chosen to become a nurse?
Well, as for me personally, nursing profession, I like it. I like the job. I want to serve my community, my own people, as a nurse, professionally. Yes.
Yes, this CHN, Community Health Nurse, has made a lot of impact in the health sector. Now, where there is no doctor, there is a CHN. Where others are signed to go, the CHN is going there at the grassroots level. The attrition of nurses is very high, but the CHN is still at the village level. How many of us are prepared to go to the village level? Very few of us. And if you look at the health indicators, the maternal and child health death rates have reduced. Health is now accessible to more people than before. So we have made a lot of impact. Now if you look at the people around, they are healthier today than yesterday. So it's a tremendous improvement that has taken place over the years. And the CHN has made a lot of contribution towards that.
While trainees in Mansakonko specialize in community nursing, their fellow second-level counterparts in Bansang are prepared for bedside nursing. The principal tutor at the state-enrolled nursing school there is Margaret Gomez.
We train them so that wherever they go, they'll be able to work. If you take, for example, in other countries, you are trained to be specialized in certain areas. But here you are trained across the board. You are a doctor, you are a nurse, any type of work you are supposed to do. Mm-hmm. Module 5 and 6 is obstetric, gynae and pediatrics. And normally with this module, we have 4 weeks classroom teaching. Then after we send half of the class to Royal Victoria Teaching Hospital and the other half are supposed to be here. So after 3 months they will swap. Those who were working at the Bansang Hospital will swap with those who are working at Royal Victoria Teaching Hospital, so that they can have the experience from Bansang and also from Royal Victoria Teaching Hospital. So it's just only 4 weeks classroom base. After 3 months, they come back for their mid-block lectures. Then after, they swap again. And just recently, about 2 weeks ago, the seniors have just qualified. They completed their training and they're waiting for the CNO to post them. And the posting should take place on the 28th of this month. They will be working in different facilities in the Gambia.
Mm. When the child came here for the first day, for the admission, she was admitted on the 16th. The child was suffering too much. But within 2-3 days, the child started recovering. And we checked the hemoglobin, it was 8.2. But now, at the moment, the hemoglobin is 8.4. And everything is getting better. And the child is recovering. Today we do the x-ray, but it's normal. The case is clear. Nothing is wrong with the child. Yes, it's just left with the doctor to decide whether she discharge her today or tomorrow. It's left to the doctor now. We are waiting for the doctor to come.
So it's you who has been working principally with this patient?
Yes, obviously. Since 2 weeks back, I was here with this patient.
So you are satisfied with the progress?
Yes, I'm satisfied, yes, really. Because the child is getting better. She's no better to me.
That means you like nursing?
Yes, I really like nursing. Since I was in school, I like nursing because I was at the Red Cross before I joined nursing.
Okay, Umisane, thank you very
much. Umisane Tamba, my husband is Tamba.
Okay. You want to include your husband?
Yes, okay. Yes.
So where is your husband now?
My husband is staying at Serekunda.
We have this midwifery training. This training started way back in 1979. And all along the training was taking place in Banjul. It is only this year that we decided to move the training here so that everything will be under the umbrella of State Enrolled School of Nursing. If we go around, I'll show you the dormitories for the midwives. And this is the year that we started training midwives in this institution. Formerly, they are trained at Royal Victoria Teaching Hospital. And also, we've got a computer lab. For the first time, we have a computer lab. But that is sponsored by a friend in UK called Anita Smith. She has donated us with about 12 computers. And if you go around in each office, you have a computer. And we've got a special computer lab for the students. Now, there is no problem of going to the library so often. All of them will go to the lab, to the computer lab, then go into the net, search what they want to search, and then they write their project work. And if you compare the marks before and right now, now they are scoring at least 70 and above because of this computer lab. Technology is very, very important.
Mm-hmm. We are trying to type out a program of activities on the HIV/AIDS sensitization. And this should take place next week.
Despite the high demand for training places at the state-enrolled nursing school, the Department of State for Health and Social Welfare is being sorely challenged by the very high attrition rate among nursing staff.
If you compare the salary of those who are in non-governmental organization and those who are in government, there is a vast difference. Just imagine a colleague of mine is paid about $10,000 and I'm here with less than $3,000. I think that's the main reason why they are leaving. And also incentive. Definitely incentive is very important wherever you're working, be it in government or non-governmental setup. So these are the main reasons. And training, again, sometimes you are trained and it will take another 5 years before you are trained. Definitely these are the things that are making nurses to leave very early.
The high attrition rates, not just doctors, but for nurses who emigrate to UK, America, or other Western places for better remuneration. We are trying to address that too. Right now, we have a policy on human resource development and an action plan has been developed on that too. The idea behind those two documents is to make sure we have in place an attractive work workforce that will be motivated to stay and work in the Gambia.
We have come up with ways and means of addressing the attrition rate. And let me also make it clear that the attrition rate is higher in what is called the SRN category. We call it the state registered nurses. Those are those people who wear this white and the red belt. They are state registered nurses. So they are qualified and they're experts. So there, the West will tend to attract them. But most of our SEMs, we call it the state-enrolled nurses, and the CHNs, the community health nurses, the attrition rate is not that very high. But however, we are also experiencing attrition, not from the Gambia to UK or America, okay, inter, but we are also having intra from our health sectors to the private NGOs. We also have poaching there. Here also we are coming up with certain aspects of policy to reverse that trend, even if you cannot reverse it, but to mitigate the impact of migration. And the policy is towards its final stages, and it will be implemented, and I hope that we are going to have a high-profile implementation. We will invite all our partners in development to see what we can do. But I'm hopeful that once the policy is implemented, certainly we will mitigate to a significant degree the effect of migration.
In the maternal and child health area, a major shift in program emphasis has been adopted.
Today, the same MCHFP program is now called the National Reproductive and Child Health Program, but not just by change of name, but also by change of services for the better, meaning that the MCH only used to target women, pregnant women, and children below the age of 5 years. Today, we are talking about a broader-based target for the reproductive health program, meaning that men in their reproductive age, as well as non-pregnant women in their reproductive age, including pregnant women and children below the age of 5 years, and more importantly, adolescent and youths, are now taking on board the National Reproductive and Child Health Program. The Gambia was able to, successfully implement the IMCI strategy. IMCI is the Integrated Management of Childhood Illnesses, meaning that children below the age of 5 years in the past would have only got treatment for the complaint that the mother came with to the clinic. But today, using this WHO UNICEF strategy of IMCI means that this child is seen in totality. If the mother comes to the clinic and complains that this child has diarrhea, we are not only going to be interested to tackle the problem of that diarrhea. Our service providers will assess that child from head to toe and see whether that child has other underlying infections like chest infections or even malnutrition, and that child receives total care. And the care is extended up to the family and community level. So that's a major achievement, compared to the way children were being managed at our health facilities.
The Gambia has the highest immunization coverage in Africa. The World Health Organization, WHO, has designated 6 diseases against which children should be protected through immunization. The Gambia is giving immunization cover to our children against 9 diseases.
For the Gambian EPI program, we are really blessed that we have this program widespread all over the country. I would say from Banjul to Koine, every government facility is a vaccination point, including even some of the private clinics. We are also trying to encourage them, and some of them have already taken on board vaccinating children. And the actual way we go about this immunizing children is we are using 2 different strategies. One is a fixed strategy, the other one is a mobile strategy. And the fixed strategy is a strategy whereby mothers and kids will come and meet us at our clinics and we give them the necessary vaccines. The mobile strategy is where the health team moves up to a community once or twice a month and administer the same services. And the Gambian EPI program is an integrated package. We don't only give immunization. We give maternal and child health, that includes antenatal care, and also giving mother supplements during pregnancy. We do growth monitoring, and we give them information on child care, child nutrition, vaccinations, and treatment of children that are sick. So it's a comprehensive package. Once a mother gets to a facility, you are obliged to have all these services once you require them. Over 90% of our Gambian children have received all of these vaccinations. And this has really helped also in terms of disease reduction, because we have a monitoring system whereby all cases that visit our facilities are reported back to us on a monthly basis. And because of the fact that coverage is high, we are seeing a lower disease incidence of these EPI target diseases. And in actual fact, this has really contributed to the reduction of child mortality in the Gambia.
In addition to immunization, another front in which the fight against childhood illnesses is being prosecuted is in the control of malaria. Malaria is one of the leading causes of high morbidity and mortality in children under 5 years of age and pregnant women. It is reckoned that 20% of antenatal consultations and 40% of under 5 visits to our health facilities throughout the country are due to malaria. In 1998, health centers reported a total of 215,000 cases. Of this number, 200,000 were children under 5 years and the rest antenatal patients. Today, the Gambia is leading the sub-regional effort against malaria and is coordinating the rollback malaria component of the Health for Peace initiative, a grouping of 5 countries, Guinea-Bissau, Senegal, Guinea, Liberia, and the Gambia, all committed to the promotion of peace through various health initiatives. Among the measures in this all-out war against malaria is the countrywide program to popularize the use of impregnated mosquito bed nets. The National Malaria Control Program's coverage for insecticide-treated bed nets has increased to about 60%. An impregnated mosquito net can keep away mosquitoes for up to 6 months, provided it is not washed.
Bed net dipping is one of the strategies we use for malaria control and prevention. Like you've already seen, vector control is broad, and this bed net dipping is one of our vector control strategies. Under our vector control strategies, what we normally do is we sensitize communities to dip their bed nets because it is a very cost-effective strategy for malaria control. What we do is at household level, we do bed net dipping. At community level too, we do it. Like this one has been done at household level. When it is done at household level, what we normally do is the individual families buy their nets and then we visit them with our dipping kits. Now we are using Delta Metering KO tabs. It is a prepared dipping package. It comes everything, inside. When we have the pack, it has a tablet, KO tablet, one tablet, which is sufficient to dip one bed net. And it comes also with a measuring bag for 1 liter of water. So inside the bag, you have your gloves, you have your, 1 liter plastic container for water, and you have your KO tablet. It's all over the country, wherever you go in the Gambia, you can have this, chemical you need to dip your bed net. And countrywide too, we have trained in each village at least 2 dipping agents. We call them dipping agents. These are people that have been identified by their own communities. And the Masina National Malaria Control Program has trained them on this bed net dipping procedures. So in each village now, all over the country, we have trained at least 2 people to do bed net dipping. Within the urban, we have our public health officers and community health nurses all over our health facilities. So wherever you go, you can access, this service if you cannot do it yourself. You know, this ITN program has been found to be a very, very cost-effective strategy all over the, African region. It has been proved to reduce malaria morbidity, that is sickness due to malaria, by 50% and mortality by 20%. So it is very effective. When you sleep under a mosquito net, you have 20% chances of not dying from malaria. You have 50% chances of not even getting the disease. So it is very cost effective and effective as a strategy as well.
Another strategy employed by the malaria control program is to attack the mosquitoes at their breeding grounds using chemicals that kill their larvae.
These are some of the preventive measures against malaria. We have other measures, of course. You have the ITNs, vector control, IAC. But this biolarvicide is one measure that is what we use to reduce the mosquito population or the larval density, so that at least it will bring the mosquito population down to control at least malaria situation in the Gambia. Prevention is better than cure. So it's very important for us at least to do everything that we can to prevent ourselves from being infected with malaria parasite. So one way of doing that is at least by making sure that we control or reduce the mosquito population in our environment by at least applying this biological agent in the breeding sites, that can help reduce the mosquito population. And that's what we are doing. We've done that in many parts, in almost all parts of the country, in the Riceville, CRD, URD, LRD. We've so far applied this biological agent in about 2,000 hectares of rice upcountry. All these measures are geared towards reducing the incidence of malaria in the Gambia, because these are measures that the National Malaria Control are undertaking to reduce the morbidity and mortality rate of due to malaria in the Gambia. We have other measures like case management is there, intermittent preventive treatment, that's IPT, is around the other area. You have IEC, vector control, research, and so these are all measures that the malaria control program is taking with other NGOs and partners to control or to reduce the morbidity rate of due to malaria in the Gambia.
Yet another coordinating role assigned to the Gambia under the Health for Peace Initiative is the prevention of blindness. This new responsibility recognizes the fact that eye care services in the Gambia are the most advanced and most successful in sub-Saharan Africa.
Today, nobody needs to move more than 10 kilometers maximum to reach an eye care provider, which is a remarkable achievement, I would say unique to the Gambia, in at least this region. And what is more remarkable is that when we did a survey, we were able to see that we have reduced the blindness prevalence down to 0.4%, which is comparable to even European standard. And our surgeries, particularly for cataract, we are using the most modern technique. That is, you do surgery instead of wearing thick lenses. I'm sure you have seen, you may have seen some people walking around with thick lenses. Mm. But nowadays, we do microsurgery, even at community level. Right in Banjul here, down to Fatoto, microsurgery can be done with an intraocular lens implant for cataracts, and you have a very satisfactory vision. And beyond that, we are providing similar services outside to our neighbors.
We followed an eye care team from its base at the AFPRC hospital in Farafenye to Kaur Health Center, where the community ophthalmic nurse had assembled 6 patients requiring eye surgery. A patient is readied before being taken into the surgery. There, cataract surgeon Sajo Kanyi and his team of assistants went to work to restore their sight and prevent them from going blind.
Was seen by the community ophthalmic nurses during his routine home visits, and he found that the old man has cataract, so he booked him for cataract surgery. I was informed last week that he has some patients for surgery. So presently what I'm doing for him, I'm doing a cataract surgery. Extraocular cataract operation with posterior chamber IOL. What I'm doing now is I'm trying to break the lens, the anterior capsule. After breaking the anterior capsule, then you remove the lens and try to implant another lens. So at this stage now, what we are trying to do is to try to open the eye so that we can remove the cataract, which is obstructing the vision. That one was the nucleus. So now what we are trying to remove is the cortex, the cortical matter from the anterior chamber, so that you can put your lens inside properly, no problem. See, we are trying to wash it out using normal saline. The normal drip we use when we have patients in our wards. You can see now everything is cleared now. So I'm going to implant the lens now. The lens is in this sealed container. It's already sterile. So now I will open it, implant it inside the eye, and close the eye. So after surgery, we normally give injection to all our patients. This is gentamicin plus dexamethasone. Dexamethasone is a steroid to suppress any inflammation. The gentamicin is the antibiotic in case of any secondary infection. But you could see when Bakari was injecting the patient, he had to clean the eye with povidone. We normally clean them before we give them an anesthesia, and before we start surgery also, we clean the eyes to make sure that we don't compromise quality, because these are rural patients. If you spoil one patient's eye from Kaurujanekunda, forget it. You will never get a patient from there. Because they will sit in the same bandaba and say, I went to Kauru, my eye was operated and I cannot see. So you will never get any patient from that environment. So that's why we are very careful in our selection criteria. Yes. We always try to do straightforward cases so that we will not compromise the quality. So this is our second patient. He has a very good procedure, no problem. He's okay now. So he's going out. We are expecting another patient now. That's tetracycline. Some of these people have been waiting for surgery for almost 5, 6, 7 months because there was no nurse station here So, but with the coming of Kabir here has facilitated things, because you can see now patients are coming now having surgery at their in their own homes rather than traveling up to Farafeni, which sometimes causes them a lot of inconvenience, because eye patients are normally two. When they go with their escorts. And you know we are in the rainy season now. To deprive two men from a household, that's how it will have an effect at the end of the season. Yes. Okay, Baba, thank you very much. This one is patient number two, so we are going up to six. Well, what I was doing a procedure called cataract surgery with intraocular lens, posterior chamber IOL. Before, the surgery we do was intraocular, we remove the whole lens. After the surgery, we give a patient a very big glasses, goggles. Sometimes these goggles fall down and they break and they cannot be replaced because you cannot get it in the market. Sometimes the grandchildren will throw them down. So due to some developments that are taking place in the country, and because Gambia is taking a lead in the sub-Saharan Africa as far as the eye care is concerned, they were able to train us to become cataract surgeons with intraocular lens, which has been done in the Western world. So the procedure I was doing was ECC with posterior chamber IOL. It's not easy. Here is not my base station. My base station is in Farafeni, as you have been told by Bakari. What we are doing here, we are doing outreach services, bringing eye care services to those type of the patients. Because most of these patients, they cannot afford to pay. So the only thing the program can do is to organize cataract camps. And the only way we can also increase our cataract surgical rate is to be doing outreach services, whereby we can increase. Because most patients would like to come to Farafeni, but number one, transportation is a problem. The fare they will have to do, and somebody else has to accompany them. So that's why we are coming out, meeting the patients. This is not the only place we do surgery. We are doing surgery across the length and breadth of the whole of North Bank and Lower River Division.
Okay, would you say there is a high incidence of cataract in this area?
Well, if you look at the causes of cataract, one of the causes is senile, which is old age. And if you look at this area, as I indicated before, at the beginning of the year, for the past 2 years, there was no community ophthalmic nurse based in Kaur here. We have a nurse in Gen Sanyal. From Gen up to Kuntau, there is no eye care personnel there. Imagine you have Kaur as a major health center and Chamin also as a health center. So all these places have been functioning without ophthalmic nurse. So we sat down as a program, we said, feel that the gap is too much. And because of the number of cases we are getting from this end, we feel that there is a need for somebody to be posted here. So that was the time the program manager posted Kabir John to Kaur here. So since he came here, he has been doing a lot of groundwork, going to the community, looking at patients to see those who need surgery and those who need treatment. Fortunately, he was able to trace out 6 patients which need surgery. So he consulted me, although Kaur is part of CRD, but as far as the eye care is concerned, we are seeing it as a no man territory. Anybody who can come here and do services, well, I think we are doing it for the program. So that's why we are here. I'm here with a team, Mr. Bakar Diba, he's an ophthalmic medical assistant, and Al Ajisian, he's an ophthalmic nurse. These are the team I work with. So our work is normally facilitated by the National Eye Care Program. We are lucky we have a very good partners, that is Science Evers International. They gave us a vehicle that we use for our outreaches. And then we are able to buy us some cataract sets. These sets are very expensive. All these sets you are seeing are with the help of our donors. We are able to get them. And these sets have been used. We have been using them for the past 6-7 years because of the maintenance. After work, he takes the responsibility of cleaning them, oil them, so that for sustainability. You know.
Where did you do your training?
Well, I'm a trained SRN, state registered nurse. Then, with the help of Sight Savers, I underwent for a training in Malawi in 93 as an ophthalmic medical assistant. Then, 96 again, I went back to do my cataract surgery. So, since then, I've been practicing as a cataract surgeon, but I am still aiming to train further, okay, to further my education.
Okay. Yes. Now, you have only 6 patients today waiting for you. Does that mean that the incidence of cataract and blindness is greatly reduced in this country?
Yes, because if you see what is happening in the Gambia here now, we are not only based, we are moving out, meeting the patients in our homes. So if they don't come, we meet them. Wherever they go, we meet them. So if you see Gambia going out to Senegal, Guinea-Bissau, assisting them, then our home is almost finished now. Although we are still seeing some few cases, if you look at Kaur, Kaur is just near the border. So some of the patients coming in might be Gambians, but because they are married there. But I think the incidence is going down generally because of the good work that we are doing as a program. starting from the program manager to the last person. Everybody's playing his role.
My role here is to be an assistant, immediate assistant to the cataract surgeon. Because I was trained in the Gambia here. We were the first batch who started the school, regional ophthalmic training program in the Gambia. I was lucky to be one of the people who were lucky to be trained in the Gambia as ophthalmic medical assistant. We were four in number, and the program felt it necessary that every eye unit in this country should have an assistant. That's an OMA. Because initially what happened was all the cataract surgeons were in their radio stations without assistants. So they said, as an ophthalmic medical assistant should be posted in each station. So that's the way we were distributed among the stations. So I was posted to Farafenya to be an assistant to the cataract surgeon, Sally.
Okay, but when you look at the hierarchy, you are also aspiring to become a cataract surgeon.
Exactly, exactly.
Okay, what do you have to do to reach the stage of
surgery? Yeah, that's what we are doing at the moment. He has to put me through, has to show me how the procedure, you know, from stage one to the end. So sometimes he gives me a chance to at least have a taste of the instrument. Because one day I'm expecting to go back to the school and then, you know, take up cataract surgery as a course.
After every surgery, I'll clean everything, oil, and pack. We have done about two cases. This one is already sterilized. This one is not sterilized. So from here, I will take it, wash it, discard what I have to discard, what I have to sterilize, I wash it, and put it in that SES 2000, that machine there. That is a sterilizer. And within 15 minutes, it will sterilize everything. So I will put it on the tray again for another patient.
So how many sets do you have altogether?
We have four sets.
Four sets.
Yes.
So that's quite adequate for a day's work.
Yes, that's quite adequate for a day's work.
Are you also aspiring to become a surgeon?
Yes.
Yeah. How many years before you get to the position of a surgeon?
Maybe you can estimate of 6 years.
6 years.
Yes.
Okay, good luck to all of you.
Mm-hmm.
I am the one responsible of going to the community, screen them, and I identify those who have problem and those who need surgery. Those who need surgery, I have to book them. Then I inform my senior officer, that is SK, then he'll come for surgery. Those who need treatment, I'll treat them. But me, I'm not trained for perform this surgery. So I can only treat, but I cannot perform surgery. So when they need surgery, I have to book them till they are up to 5 to 6 patients. Then I inform him to come and operate them.
Yeah. Shortly after his eye surgery, Sheikh Cisse of Kaur spoke to us.
Sheikh Cisse.
Sheikh Cisse, fan nga baye ko?
Kaur of Town.
Kaur of Town.
Yeah.
Lan bu won wax lan bu won waxtana yow lan mo la fi isité ci l'hôpital bi fi?
Body nakale.
Body nakale. Legi gis nañ né ñoo nga am opéré nañ sa body. Ndax body bi yagana la metti ndax?
No yagana wana néw dem du don metti. Year 2000 March. April, May, you know, I start the Nakade. He's a Dagan Delendam, from a Gitelendam. It takes 2 years, Mutkumas attack Karabi. Legibim take a firm,
Rabbi,
he gives good answers. The Nagis Lulair near the Nahua, the Mamuna Hamlala. From a Jagane Kombi, the Alessian Garoba near the Wadutama, Munakaranya Lala. I'm not a Roba on a wreck.
I'm Hamnanya, what would you? Lo xamna la ciir la ci doomi adama ndax yow da nga tok rek nga ne xara ma dem ñu opéré ko parce que amna ño xamne ñu bari buñu daan nangu ñu opéré sa ligoti na dafa am ku ñew rek na la dañ ko wara opéré buñ ko opéré wu do gis ak yoy ñu
wel bi ma commencé es dama dé dég opéré ma na ma ñu ne ma dang ko opéré ma na opéré sama ben frère mu ne bëgg gumba do opéré da gumba ma na da ma gumba way gëna opéré dana koy dindi na try yépp ngi loxo yalla rek su wéré ma xamné non la su wér ba té ma yalla ma tlol ci man
wa yo fo nga ni opéré bi nga def ni dina la mëna dimbali bu baax
amna ci yaakar bu baax baax dé insha allah yaakar na ko lol wa
baax na jéré def ko dina ñaanal lo wéré jaax
am yaar bi yalla ene yalla bool defal japp ñun ñepp yalla ma ngi sutu na fa na gudd and ak gëram ak mu gëra nak am da
fay na ma mat am da fa mu la faté la opéré bi parce que gis nañ ne biñ la opéré
yéga tulo defulo dara ndax gemeti am bi metti yego mako sax ma ngi fone opéré gol sax dama de ma ngi laaj ki ma ko commencé ñu opéré bi mu ne ma paré na
kon
Non, je suis un friend. 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 Je suis un
friend.
Je suis un friend. Je suis un friend. Je lima xalé yé mo do ñu injé so bi touti ré bam tout la ci yégg rek ak apart problème la yéguma tamon daru ñu xam ñu man daru da yéguma
baax
na ñu def thank you very much.
On the return leg of our tour of health facilities round the country, we crossed the river one more time and swung back down the South Bank Road to Kaur. There we sought out Cheikh Cissé, finally finding him at home with his family.
Ndax légui fu nekk ni contane nga am defal nañ la operation bi nam successful na ya bu ñëk bi do daan gis légui ya nga gis ndax contane nga
contane bi gay mënuma am limite mënuma wax limite bi dal comme tane bi ma ci contane na ni la tollu mënuma ko bala nga xam ndax gis neena nga ñaka gis ba gis fekkat la ci xago bo febaru do yërem ku febar parce que na jaar la ci febar ku febar do dara aso ci jaar na nga xam ki gumbon be xol mo la mëna li neexay gis ayam yo mo do gis di dem rek xamula ko xamula ko de
docteur bi la opéré nak lan nga am pour wax ci koku
koku waro na xam numu tuday fu mu nek sax mo ko defal di ut lu mako defal koku content nañu trop te xamna mo na ligéyam ni mo gisé non param ñu ñu overé overé bu nek bu gi féké morom bay ligéy féké la moy ligéy mo na dañu xam dañu xam man nak maçon la dama détta amaleta amna sama body li ci krika yu bari lolou mako doli la
ndax jox nañ la rendez-vous pour ngeen delou wat ci l'hôpital bi ñu sétat sen boti
am frade aji ma dañu wara delat ci ségal ñu baxam inshallah
baax na jere jere.
With the support of Sight Savers International, a British organization previously known as the Royal Commonwealth Society for the Blind, the Gambia is now the training center for eye care staff from the sub-region. On the day we looked in at the regional eye care training center, a student from Cameroon training to become a community ophthalmic nurse is surrounded by her tutors as she does her practical examinations in the ophthalmic ward of the Royal Victoria Teaching Hospital.
Being a community nurse, we are trained at basically the community level. We have more to do with the community, to deal with the community directly, because the levels, they are divided into three. You have the primary, you have the secondary, you have the tertiary. Like in the hospital here is the tertiary level. But we are going to work directly with the community to meet with those people at the grassroots. Then in case of any problem that is above us, we can refer it now to the secondary and the tertiary level. But minor cases and health education and giving the, making the people to be aware, it is our own objective that we are supposed to do.
We run programs for all levels of eye care, from doctors right down to the lowest level, which are the community ophthalmic nursing level. So the programs are the community ophthalmic nursing course, which is the lowest level, but which is the most important because they are in contact with the people in the smaller towns. And then we have the ophthalmic nursing training program. And then we have the advanced diploma in surgical ophthalmic training, which is, in simple terms, they are the cataract surgeons. And then we have the diploma in ophthalmology, which is part of the West African College of Surgeons program. And then we also train refractionists. So we see that all these people work as a team, and we also train them as a team. We train them together, so from the training they have, they know how to work with each other. Yeah. So those are the main programs that we run.
What are the countries in the region, the sub-region, who are participating in this training program?
Well, the countries go, as I said, go beyond the Health for Peace initiative. We have Guinea-Bissau, we have Senegal, we have Cameroon, Sierra Leone, Liberia. And this year we are also expecting people from Guinea-Conakry. Yeah. We even had people 2 years ago from Nigeria.
I'm doing an advanced diploma in ophthalmic surgery.
Advanced diploma in ophthalmic surgery?
We call it cataract surgery.
Okay. How long is your course, Mr. Jalo?
Our course is about 12 months.
12 months?
Yeah.
And at what stage of the course are you at now?
Just now we will finish because we have only 2 weeks left. Mm. And we are on revision now and we will have our exam on the 8th of July.
And when you do get your qualifications and your certificate and your diploma, what exactly will you be competent to do?
After our qualification, we will go back to Senegal to do cataract surgery. And we have to do before 6 months an internship, but we have to do in our internship in Senegal. So after internship, we will be posted somewhere in Senegal and we will do cataract surgery.
And you will become fully qualified cataract surgeons in your own right?
Yes.
And cataract surgeons means, what do you do? What kind of work do you do in the field?
You know, the problem of blindness now in Senegal, in Gambia, it is about cataract. So really, the person who will do cataract is a medical doctor, surgeon. But we see that there is not enough ophthalmologists. So they want to train cataract surgeon. So to reduce the backlog of cataract in Senegal.
So how have you found your course?
This course was very interesting, and I have exchanged a lot of experience with a colleague of Gambia. And you know, in Gambia, their eye program is very successful. So I get a lot of experience. So when I go back, I think I will try to work in my country and to give more experience that I have here in Gambia.